Croeso and all, welcome back everyone to the Fearless in Devotion podcast, sponsored by the Fat Ball Bar and Restaurant. It's me, Liam, Tim and Andy with you this week. Andy's being held hostage in a bed sit somewhere in East London by the looks of things. He's got a new webcam and it's
East London?
I don't know. That seems to me that's where bed sits are.
Out of all the things you could have taken issue with then, not the fact that you said he's been held hostage, the fact that you got the wrong part of London. As a, the most.
I pay a lot of money not to be in East London, mate.
There yeah. We are.
Fair enough. We're in a good mood again, people. Another good win and an away win. Tim, I mean, it's not very often that we can say that these days, so they are to be cherished, aren't they?
Yeah, it's been a long time coming, really. Well, it definitely feels that way. Few and far between. And after the first 20 minutes, you thought, here we go again. It's going to be a long afternoon. But after we scored, it was pretty much one-way traffic, really. It was just nice to sort of see us transfer those home performances on the road. And it's like I said, it's been a long time coming, but it was great. It was really good. Really, really solid performance. Not really anybody that you could really dig out too much. It was just really, really good. And as away days go, definitely one of my favourites this season by far. Just everything about it was bob on. Atmosphere, the noise, just great.
That's great to hear. Obviously, I missed last week's podcast when you were discussing Forest Green, which I went to. And I must admit that it couldn't be much more of an opposite feeling. It was absolutely diabolical. And you might, some people might consider me to be the happy clapper of the podcast. I was far from a happy clapper that Tuesday night. I was, get Humphrey back on. Why haven't you sacked Parky yet? It was terrible. But what a turnaround it's been since that Forest Green game, Andy, where we seem to be picking up some form again, not just winning, but deservedly winning at just the right time.
I think Parky said something in the post-match interview. He said he's got a lot of players in that squad who like this part of the season. And I think he's right. I think you've got the likes of James McLean, you've got Stephen Fletcher. These are people who won't be overawed by going into a League Two promotion battle. They'll absolutely relish it. They'll be thinking of that promotion bonus at the end of the season. That's what they're going to be collapsing on. Like the likes of MK Dons making a run or anything like that will not mean anything to them. They'll zone in on the prize. They're people who won't get phased. It's not just McLean and Fletcher. You've got other people there like Mullin who's done this before, even Tozer as well. So yeah, I think that was a season defining weekend. I really do. I think to put that level of performance in away from home against a top 10 team is what we've been waiting for since Notts County. And I think it's quite ominous for the rest of the teams in this league. I really do.
Yeah, really, really sound performance. And, you know, one of those away games out of the way, the majority of games you've got left now are home. Liam, there was some bitterness towards the referee from certain sections of the Morecambe fan base. I mean, the red card was a bit soft, I think, wasn't it? But I mean, I don't think there could be many arguments other than that.
Yeah, I looked at it back because I was mostly listening on the radio. So I thought I'd see what the fuss was about because it sounds like we got away with one. But should have definitely had a penalty for the trip on James McLean in the first half. I don't think they can argue whatsoever with the penalty we did actually get given as well. If you look at the position the guy's arm was in, the sending off may be a bit harsh, but I just think back to all the times that Palmer's had his shirt dragged halfway up his back this season and been given bugger all. So these things have a tendency to even themselves out. So some of the stuff just came across really bitter. It was the usual referee wants to be on Netflix type of thing. It's like you watch it back and I can see why he's made the penalty call definitely. And if anything, we should have had another one.
Yeah, I think absolutely. something like that. Tim, you were at the game, so you probably get more of a feel of what the referee was like overall. He just, I mean, you know, not to give that Wrexham penalty in the first half. I don't know if he was being, you know, Morecambe fans will say, oh, he's corrupt, but maybe just a bit overawed by the occasion. What do you think, Tim?
To be honest, I didn't really notice much about the referee because it was a case of, it was such a weird game. First 20, all Morecambe. Thereafter, pretty much all of us. So I didn't I think using the referee as an excuse is kind of doing Morecambe a disservice for their initial first 20-minute performance, you know, and the hours thereafter. I just think the game and the way it panned out took precedent and no refereeing decisions. I didn't think he was that bad.
That, and I was like, going to say, that's the mark of a good ref, Tim.
No, I'm not saying... if I genuinely thought a referee was shite for both sides, I'd say it. I think they really were clutching. They're really clutching at straws to sort of suggest that he was biased and this, that, and the other. And I mean, the first yellow card for Melbourne, wasn't it, got sent off? The first yellow card was probably soft, looking back at it. Didn't think that was one, but the second one is. People argue that, oh, well, Palmer shouldn't be going down like that. But Melbourne's not exactly a small lad himself. So, and somebody said to me on Twitter, oh, well, you know, yeah, the referee allowed your players to bully us. How'd you figure that one out? You just got bullied by players better than you. And I think people can try and use this weird narrative that we didn't deserve it. But if you ask any Morecambe fan, forget the referee incident for a minute. Who deserved to win that game on the day? You'd have to be blinkered to say it was the home side, because it wasn't. You know, we had 20 odd shots on goal.
Yeah, as a general rule as well, I mean, ref chat is boring, isn't it? Because, I mean, usually it's very rare that the ref has influenced the game more than your team. Always look at home first before you look at the ref. Speaking of people in the team and who was... McLean seems to have nailed his spot in midfield. Andy, would you agree with that?
Oh, yeah, definitely. I mean, you know... any criticism I've had of McLean is I didn't see him as a long-term left wing back, but in midfield,
you've been heavily critical of McLean, didn't you? You said he was rubbish. Heavily. You said he's doesn't deserve a spot on the team.
That. Absolutely, you're rewriting history.
Heavily.
God,
sorry, I was paraphrasing.
Yeah, but what I did say is, you know, it's hard for a lad of his age to come in and play wing back. And I think we look more solid with Mendy there, who's a natural wing back, and McLean has added that energy, that guile, and that drive into midfield. And yeah. I'm just really pleased for him, because I think he's made that midfield unit tick. He's made it work, and he's got a little bit of everything, hasn't he? You know, he can get back in and put a tackle. He does press. He does have a good pass on him. He's got a good cross on him. You know, he's got an engine that will go up and down. He's really added to that unit, and he's let the likes of someone we're going to come and talk about in a minute. He's given them license to really play, I think. Well done to him. I praise him, because I knew he was a quality player. I just thought he was in the wrong position.
He's also got a good finish, because that finish...
Brilliant.
Not
and the Swindon one.
Bobbly pitch. Man's got back on the line. So he's got two players to beat there, and he sticks it between both of them. The keeper's not saving that anyway. No chance.
Mullin's done well there. Yeah. Mullin's picked the right pass there. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah.
Well, Andy, we're all really glad that Parky finally listened to you. Moving on from in midfield, Andy Cannon, right? I mean, how good was he, Tim?
Oh, I mean, you know how good of a player is on that performance when you see a lot of sudden calls for, is he making a late charge of player of the season? You'd be hard-pushed to argue not. I mean, just consistently good at what he does. And if you think back, I mean, the season's gone so quick. 10 games left at the point of recording this. Remember when he got sent off? Wasn't that long ago? And people thought, oh, his head's gone. And you know, the sort of knee-jerk reaction to that was crazy. Or will we see him in a Wrexham shirt again? And he's just been brilliant. You know, two promotions under his belt already, two in a row. He's going for a third. He just makes everything look easy. He works hard. He's brave. He gets his head in where nobody wants to stick it. He's always looking forward. He's always looking to pick the right pass. But the good thing about Andy Cannon is that the more I see of him, the more comfortable he looks on the ball. And I think what Andy just said before, these players crave this point of the season to say, look, well, here we are now. We're at the business end. We've got the experience that will see this team through. And I think they will. I think they will.
Speaking of Andy Cannon, regular listeners will know we have a regular feature called The Book of Okonkwo, where Tim comes up with fantastic songs and puts lyrics to them, celebrating our fantastic goalkeeper, Arthur Okonkwo. This week, Humphrey Carr on Twitter, a friend of the podcast, said that it's disgraceful that there's no song for Andy Cannon, which is right. So Tim has taken it upon himself to try and get one going. I think it's fair to say, is your, we can't call it Book of Okonkwo. What can we call it? The canon of canon. There we go. The canon of canon.
No, can we have it the I don't know, the chapter of canon?
Okay, fine. Yeah, chapter of canon. The chapter of canon. Tim, take it away.
Have you got all right, well, disclaimer, I genuinely, walking the dog like 2 hours ago before recording this, and it came into my head, I was like, that's really good. And then put it on Twitter, and then Super Sub on Twitter had also done something similar, I think the day before. So he's got to take some credit for this as well, massively. It's just great minds. I'm assuming there's going to be more than just two people that have come up with this. But anyway, original band, Earth, Wind and Fire, the song September goes a little bit something like this. Feel it. Feel it. Oh, yo. Super Andy Cannon. Oh, yo. He swears he saw a lion. Oh, yo. He never gives the ball away. Repeat.
Love it.
Andy's shaking his head
and staring blankly into the void. What's wrong, Andy?
It's like being confronted by shit Louis Walsh.
Ride a buzzer. Actually, what do they do on The Voice?
They just stay.
Isn't that the Mighty Boosh? He just turns his back on you.
That's what we should do every week now for our Book of a Conquer. We should all turn around and only turn around if we like it.
Do you have the back of your hair squared or tapered, Andy?
I have it tapered, mate.
Right, okay, yeah, I was just looking
the
then.
Even when you're being held hostage.
I am tied to a radiator.
Right. Anyway, it's time to introduce our special guest this week, I think, who is in the virtual waiting room right now. I'm hoping that he'll be joining us soon. Tim, would you like to introduce our special guest once he joins? We're very, very excited that he's joined us because... anyone who's been through Wrexham recently will be familiar with this gentleman's works.
Yeah, so we thought we haven't had a sort of, well, we've been spoilt with guests recently with Parky and Humphrey and so on. So we thought, let's get somebody else who has contributed to Wrexham AFC football culture and just generally contributed massively to the town in general. He is known, his artistic name is the Pencil Craftsman. He will be known to most other people as Liam Stokes-Massey. You can find him in Tea Power with his cool little hut doing all sorts of wonderful illustrations. He's done illustrations for the Fearless and Devotion fanzine in the past and done a load of wonderful prints, loads of T-shirts. But most importantly, arguably, but the reason we've got him on here today is to talk about all the murals he's done around the town, the latest being of one super Phil Parkinson. Mr. Stokes-Massey, welcome. How are you?
Thanks for having me. Yeah, good, thanks. How are you all? All right?
Yeah, good, mate. Good, good. Thanks for coming on. Where to begin? Before we sort of delve into the more recent stuff, give us a bit of a potted history of people who might not know, because am I thinking this right, that you are a self-taught artist?
Yeah. So I've been doing it for a long time now. So this is actually my 10th year as a full-time job. But before that, I did it for a few years, kind of like on the side while working part-time elsewhere. So I started off just doing like pencil portraits and whatnot for people. You know, the same thing I kind of do now a little bit, like kids and the dogs and stuff like that. But then over the years, it's just kind of developed into something a bit more... Well, a lot more football focused, and yeah, like being like a massive football fan, it was kind of inevitable that was going to make its way into my work at some stage. So,
what did you do when you were doing it part time? What was the sort of pre artistic career?
Well, I was living in. I moved to Nottingham for a year. I know. And then I'd lived in Cardiff for 5 years, went to uni there, and then moved to Nottingham for a year, working on a strangely enough, a Welsh language switchboard for winter fuel payments, which is so random to get a Welsh language job in Nottingham. But and then I moved back to Wrexham and worked in the co-op bank for about a year, which I couldn't stomach. Like anyone who knows me would say, like, you working in a bank? No way. And it just didn't work out. And it was at that point I decided to kind of just take the plunge, and if it works, it works. If it doesn't, at least I've tried.
Has it kind of like exceeded all your expectations, like a decade along the path? Obviously, we'll delve into it a bit more now, but 10 years later, you know, I mean, you're getting all sorts of commissions as well as getting involved in the football side of things. So everything must be ticking over nicely. Has it exceeded everything you thought was going to be possible?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. To be honest, when I first started, I thought, you know, if I can keep it going for a year, that'll be kind of, you know, I'd be happy with that. That'd be some achievement. So to still be doing it 10 years down the line, and, you know, to have worked on some of the things that I've worked on. I probably wouldn't have believed you if you'd have told me 10 years ago that's what I've done. So
before I bring the other guys in, let's dive straight to your most recent work, which adorns the sort of side gates of the Turf Public House. Andy's now sharing this picture. The boss up the turf.com at Pencil Craftsman, which is Liam's Twitter handle, and Stead obviously took the picture. Take us through this. At what point is the idea pitched to you? And then how long did this take? And I mean, you know, just give us an idea of that, and you know, the materials, the man, because it is a labour of love, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. It is, especially at this time of year where it's freezing bloody cold and wet. And it was a labour of love. I mean, it came about from memory, I think around like the turn of the year, and Wayne got in touch, said he wants to, he's got the gates, the side of the pub, he wants to put a mural on them. He told me, to be honest, this was really straightforward, relatively straightforward, because he gave me everything. He said he wanted parky, he wanted a black background with white writing that said the boss. And I was like, right, sound. I think I knocked that up relatively quick, the design. And then he was happy with it. And then it was just a matter of getting it on the wall, on the fence then. So that took about 6 days. Started on the Tuesday, and that involved whitewashing the fence.
Yeah.
And I had to draw a grid onto it, which was a bit difficult given that there were slats and gaps and whatnot. And then, sketching. I've got like the grid and the image on my iPad, and essentially just getting what's on the iPad onto the fence. And then that was quite time consuming. And then I think I started painting on the Thursday. So getting all that on the wall, on the fence took, I think we finished on the Sunday, so 3 or 4 days.
How many hours a day?
To be honest, I was there quite a lot. Particularly when I'd started painting, I think I was there 10, 12 hours a day. Which is fine by me, because I think I work best when it's like that. I kind of given myself a bit of a rough deadline of kickoff on the Saturday, which obviously I didn't quite make. But I think most of it was done by then. It was just stuff that needed kind of tidying up, and so yeah, it's yeah. Lost, I lost
Liam, can I apologise because I've been in the middle of a laughing fit for the last 5 minutes because I don't think Andy realised he was still sharing his screen.
At least we know how all the Reach websites are performing though online.
If you like data protection breaches, Andy Gilpin's your man.
I've data protection breached myself, to be honest. So
I was looking for an OnlyFans email.
I'm now going through that page thinking, is there anything sensitive here that we need to
the best bit was the the stats for the article about the teacher who's ballooned to 33 stone or something.
That's a serious story. That girl's gone through a journey.
Oh God, we're nothing if not professional, are we? Bloody
good job,
hell.
Some of us are professional. I was like, don't look at the emails. Just keep
I'm so sorry. I was. Oh, yeah. I did the same. It was after the emails he uploaded. He was looking at the stats for the ballooning teacher.
I have to say Liam SM now because there's two in it. Liam SM, has Mr. Parkinson seen it yet? Are you aware? Have you seen it? Are you hoping to get a picture with him? Is he going to sign it? What's the plan with that now?
He's been aware of it that it's been going on. He actually came. He drove in to the car park at the turf on the Thursday. Did like a lap and then went back out again. So he knows it's going on.
Was he had tinted windows? Did he wind it down like a mafia boss? Have a look.
But no, I mean, I think that's going to happen. I think Wayne was going to try and make arrangements for him to come, and then let me know, and then I can meet him and say thanks and whatnot.
Well, I know Liam R has seen it in person, and I'm sure everybody else in this room agrees that the talent is undeniable, and that's not blowing smoke at your ass. It's just the truth of the matter.
Best so far, I think. I think the fact that it's black and white and it's on slats, I don't know why, but I just think that it's more striking than usual in a way. I think it's great. Yeah.
I mean, without going full sort of, full artistic critic, because of that reason, the black and white vibes, I just get ice cold, kind of like, because he's like that. Do you know what I mean? He's just fucking on it. That's what I was like. Oh, I like that kind of ice cold vibe because it's just him. He's just whatever you think about him in this recent bad run crisis, he wins games, and he doesn't pat himself on the back about it. He's just like, yep, next, love it. Anyway, that's the first of many murals. Let's backtrack. Andy, what emails are you showing us next in and around the next pictures? Let's backtrack. Have we got who's you gone with? Well, that's the same one. That's technically not a mural, but we can have it. Well, it is a mural of sorts. It's not the one on the side of the fat boar, but
yeah. So that was actually commissioned by someone in Missouri. Which was crazy. I just got a message on Twitter one day. And yeah, like from my point of view, that's probably one of my best,
right?
Personally, like, because it's weird because I'm colorblind.
What?
Like with red green colorblind, like bit of blues and purples and greens and browns and stuff like that. So, obviously, being a Wrexham and Wales fan, that can be a bit problematic at times.
That's mad.
It's not so bad. It's like, I've never had it like properly diagnosed or anything, but like I've done paintings before and I've painted some grass and my wife, Lou, will be like, babe, that grass is brown. I'm like, what? What do you mean?
I mean, pre-takeover, the racecourse grass was brown. For any audio listeners, we are currently looking at a commission of Paul Mullin celebrating a goal, being chased down by a very handsome Oliver Palmer in the background there. Since the takeover...
The match, Liam?
Pardon?
Is that the Stockport match, the celebration?
No, it's County, not County.
Yeah.
Oh, right. Yeah. Okay, yeah.
Andy's having a belter today.
Hey, showing off his new webcam. It's all gone tits up, isn't it? Andy, what you got next? Oh, before we move on to that one, Liam SM. Since the takeover, you mentioned that was a special commission that went to Missouri.
Yeah,
I'm guessing you've seen an upsurge in overseas orders as well, particularly America.
Yeah, it's been mad. I think with, especially on, Twitter, because it's such like a vibrant community of overseas fans. I seem to get a lot of orders from those guys, which is lovely and also really surreal as well. I've sent, USA, Canada, Australia. It's really good. Really good.
I've never felt so dull in my life as when I asked you on Monday how much the postage and packaging cost on that. Afterwards, I was just like cringing inside of it. Like, why did I ask?
No, mate, that's exactly where my mind went to. When I'd done it, I was, I hadn't thought about the postage or anything until I'd finished it. So I was like, oh, Christ, I'm going to have to post this now.
And yeah.
Both expecting a few £100, but it's all right.
Liam, do you want to discuss the next one? The one that we're looking at on the side of the fat ball, which obviously replaced the original Umar Ohid one with the Wales mural, Gareth Bale, and was it Nico, was it? No, was it Harry Wilson, wasn't it?
Harry Wilson, Nico, and Gareth Bale,
So that was up for how long?
Not long, actually. It went up in November, just in time for our first game against you. Was it USA, the first game, from memory? And then, so, obviously after promotion, Rich Watkin got in touch with me and said, look, I think it's probably time that we should change it. And to be honest, I was like a bit, oh God, it's a bit too soon. You know, the guys who funded the last one, Walgoch Festival, I was a bit worried that they might be a bit peeved. But to be honest, they were great. They said, we feel that it's served its purpose. Nico and Harry had both seen it. David Yuan had been to it, and I was lucky enough to meet him at the mural. So they were like dead happy to change it, because obviously the World Cup for us wasn't.
Yeah, I think it would have been a different story had we progressed.
Yeah,
along in it.
So, but yeah. Rich said, draw up a few different designs, which I did, and then this was the one that kind of like made the most sense. And it's dead happy with it.
Liam, how hard is it to sort of go from like quite a small design that you sort of would do by hand to something big like this? When you did it on the side of the fat ball with the Wales mural, was that the first time you'd done anything as big as that?
Yeah. And to be honest, I really enjoy it, because there's a little bit of maths involved, just to kind of like, so I like I said before, I'd have the design on my iPad, and you can overlay a grid onto it. So then you've got to get the dimensions of the building and then work out the ratio to scale the grid up to that size. And then, if your grid is accurate, you're in a good place then, because if you can just see where, the lines, like where Paul Mullin's ear intersects this line, you're good, basically. But the trouble with this was I couldn't go down to street level to kind of see that all my marks are in the right place, because obviously the whole wall was covered in scaffolding and then mesh as well. So you couldn't really see anything through the mesh, really. So the only time I kind of knew that everything was accurate or not was when the scaffolding was coming down like bit by bit. So my mouth, like at the side of the street, God, what if his nose is too big or his eye looks wonky or whatever? But luckily it came out all right.
How long would something like that last? So looking at like the parky one and the one on the side of the building, I mean, are we talking years here? Would you have to go and touch it up every now and again?
No, to be honest, because my missus actually helped with the Paul Mullin one. So the lovely smooth black and white lines, you see, that's her handiwork. And she helped me varnish it as well. She made sure the paint was all even. And we walked past it last night or the night before, and we were so surprised at how well it's kind of holding up. So I think that's going to be good for a while. And you know, I imagine the same with the Parky one. We covered that in a varnish just to make sure that it would be a bit, protected against the elements. And I'm sure they'll be good for some time.
It must be a right buzz when you walk past any of your work. Do you ever have that little? Do you ever go past it on your own, have a little conversation, go, yeah, it's my work, that?
No, I do, I'll be honest, I would be lying if I said I didn't get a good, a nice buzz when I go past any of them, because it's, like I said before, it's not something I ever thought I'd be doing. Travelled, to a few countries overseas, all these cities, I've got amazing murals, and it's always been a question why hasn't Wrexham got stuff like this? So, to help kind of bring that kind of stuff to the town or the city is a bit of a pinch me moment, really.
Just on that last one with the Mullin thing, can we just kind of quickly discuss the whole thing about the badge? Because, I mean, a lot of us were flummoxed initially about, I mean, it doesn't mean, because it's great to use the old coat of arms, the original club crest. What was the kind of feeling? Because my understanding was, obviously, as an intellectual property aspect. Yeah. And we even said on the pod, we were a bit dumbfounded by the club's stance on this, because you go anywhere in Wrexham and you'll see the club badge emblazoned in a pub or a McDonald's window or in a hairdresser's. So why did they deny the use in that respect?
I mean, it was disappointing. I think, I do understand to an extent why they said that we'd have to apply for a license to use it. At the end of the day, it is their IP. But like you say, in the kind of spirit of the moment, the badges are popping up all around town. It's a massive achievement that, it's celebrating. And obviously, because it was just after, fairly soon after promotion, a couple of months after promotion. It's inevitable that you're going to be disappointed if you can't make it the true representation of what you had in your mind and what the original design was.
But by the same token, it makes your piece looks more unique, and it gets people talking about where the original coat of arms came from. So, if there is no argument for common sense further down the track to use it, then at least the pluses are you are educating people about a previous club badge.
Well, that was the thinking, really. I remember having the conversation with Rich Watkin, I was literally, the badge was drawn out, I was literally about to put my first lines on it in paint, and then he came out and said, look, we've got a problem. So in those 5 minutes, we decided, right, we'll use the old badge. And obviously, that'll show people that, the club's been around for a long time. And it would be representative of the history of the club and the town. In that respect, I think it was a bit of a positive. I think we did quite well there to make a good situation out of a potentially frustrating one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In terms of, I know Andy's got a few of the pictures that obviously you've got the Mullin one, you've got Parky one, Elliot Lee in the Casual Kids Lab, isn't it? Above
Yeah.
Trainer Revival. The man himself came to look at that one, didn't he? I think, Elliot. I think he kind of marked the occasion.
Yeah, he came to the opening. Him and Jacob Mendy came as well. And they were both like the loveliest guys. They had so much time for everyone. I think they both spent at least, an hour. I think Jacob Mendy was there for a couple of hours, I think, just chatting to whoever. Dead interesting guy.
What did Elliot make of it? Because, he said everywhere, every podcast they've ever spoken to, including ours, he absolutely loves it here. So to be immortalized in the town is quite special.
Yeah, he loved it. Which is great, because that's what you want at the end of the day, isn't it? For like, if you're putting your work out there is one thing, but then to have the subject of the image come and see it and approve, that's kind of like a full house, really. But yeah, really, really good. Really good.
Liam, how far can this go? How many of these can we do? I mean, wouldn't it be nice to have them dotted around the town as sort of like a living sort of installation to where we are at the moment? I know you sort of said that if you go to cities across the world, they always make a good play of their graffiti. I'm thinking of like in Berlin, where it's almost like a part of it's a part of the tourist trail, really, isn't it? Can we do something similar here?
Yeah, well, I think that's actually in the running. I do know that the council they had plans to do a heritage mural trail. So that'd be celebrating all things Wrexham related, so not just the club. It would be, stuff like Wrexham Lager, the brick industry, all facets of like the town's culture and heritage. I think it's gone a bit. I've not heard much for a couple of months or a few months at least, but hopefully that will pick up again. And I think this town is so creative. There are so many artists who would be capable of doing a mural somewhere. It's the work would suit it so well as well. My bag, like, is, as you can see from the ones I've done, like, there are a lot of them, they're not, you're not drowning in color, they're black and white mostly, and which is great. That's just my style and what I enjoy doing. But there are so many artists in town who make really colorful, vibrant work that would go so well on a wall somewhere. So hopefully that's what I kind of hope would happen, get one big one on a wall somewhere, and then someone, it kind of like start a domino effect where they just start popping up. So hopefully that'll still happen.
Andy Cannon's next, isn't he?
Yeah, imagine that. That was brilliant.
Yeah. That's called being with a lion, isn't it?
What's that?
How good are your lions?
Yeah, no, I could pull off, especially a Lion King lion. I could pull off a Disney lion. To be honest, every single one of them deserves one. I'd love to just, how good would that be? Like my missus, she coordinated a project in where she works, and it was, the BT boxes, the little green BT boxes that are around town.
Yeah.
They commissioned like 10 artists to paint them, to just, put their own work on them, design. It just brightened up the city so much. And I don't think there's much stopping people doing that. I think you can just write to BT and, just apply to do it. As long as you let them know what's going on, they'll okay it. It's just like the financial aspect, I think, is, so if we can get some funding for something like that. Obviously, with murals, it's a bit more difficult because it depends on who owns the building, whether it's a listed building or not. So there's a few more obstacles in the way. But with the BT boxes, it's a nice little starter, if you like. So that's another possibility.
Great stuff. I mean, in terms of, have you got any other ones that you've got a burning desire to do, both footballers and anything else for that matter?
Well, yeah, obviously, I've got there's potentially some more work being done in town. Hopefully, I need to have a sit down with Rich Watkin and sort some stuff out. So that's exciting. But with this like mural trail that I'd mentioned before, that the heritage trail, I've always been dead interested in like Wrexham, like history, especially like the brick industry, which sounds dead nerdy and dead boring. But it's it's like it's fascinating. There's like, you know, Wrexham's known for like Rab and red brick and terracotta brick, and like these bricks were, you know, used to build buildings all around the world. You know, and there's like there's a company called JC Edwards who made beautiful tiles, and the story goes that there's tiles in the Taj Mahal that have got JC Edwards on, like from Wrexham. It's just like stuff like that blows my mind because not many people know about it. So I'd love to do something like a visual kind of aid, you know, or representation to kind of highlight that. Because I think, because my things are like has been over the last few years that obviously we're getting so many visitors from, you know, overseas now. And it'd just be, this is the time to kind of capitalize on that. And even for locals as well, you know, like imagine having a trail, like a historical trail where people from overseas come and they've got a little handy map and they can just follow it and they could learn so much stuff about the town or the city that is literally invisible right now. You know, like, yeah, that's my kind of like, hope, I guess.
Yeah.
Like when it comes to that, it'd be brilliant.
Yeah. Maybe get a mural on the side of Jordan Davis and Richard Watkins' new venture, the Croyce Howell in Fly, which they're now going into the business together with. That's a big sidewall on a approaching and out of some busy villages.
I can't picture, you know, I'm looking at it now and I can't kind of picture the wall. Is it the one facing like the road as you drive past on the left-hand side, if you're going like down the hill
maybe just design the new sign, whatever they decide to call it. That's all good stuff, mate, but before we crack on with the rest of the agenda, stick around and get involved in it, please. Just tell the good folk, good listeners, and where they can find your works, if you'd be so kind.
Well, I'm on all or most social media platforms, so Twitter, Instagram, Facebook. If you just search Pencil Craftsman, I've got a shop as well where I sell prints of player illustrations. Speaking of which, I've just finished my first portrait of one of the ladies players. So.
Exclusive. Who is it?
I've pretty much finished it tonight. So I've done 7 players so far, but they've all been the men's team. So I thought it's about time that I do one of the ladies team, and who better than local hero Lily Jones? So that should be available for a print as a print this week, I think.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Great.
Well, we're looking forward to seeing that and more of your work in the future. As Tim said, please stick around. We're going to crack on with the rest of the agenda because we know you're a massive Wrexham fan, obviously, yourself. Tim, on the subject of the women's team, do you have an update for us on...
consult my book. I'm like, this is your life. Like a shitty Michael Aspel, my little book. That's going to date me there. Just obviously sort of phase 2, the Adram Premier commenced today, Sunday, at the time of recording this. The women faced Swansea. They lost 3-2, unfortunately. Narrow defeat. However, they will be hosting Swansea on March 24th at the Stoke Kairos. Tickets go on sale Monday. It's a 2 o'clock kickoff for that March 24th game. Tickets are £3 for adults, quid for kids. We know, obviously, Wrexham women, they, I think they set the Welsh domestic record, didn't they, for the attended Welsh domestic attendance record last year, like 9,500, I think it was, pretty much nailed on that. So they're looking to try and either, you know, equal or eclipse that if they can. You know, the capacity is there now to eclipse it. So it's great to have the women back there, hopefully gain some swift revenge over the Swans, so that'll be good. Also, just keeping with the women, they qualified for the Butte Energy Welsh Cup final for the first time after defeating TNS 1-0 last week. And yeah, all things are going well despite this defeat. You know, they want to be in and amongst it. They've got Cardiff at the Rock next Sunday, 17th. So yeah, you know, Lily Jones, new commission by Liam Stokes-Massey, leading the charge really with the ladies in the Adrian Premier. So all good things. I really hope that the local Wrexham public turn out in force again. Obviously, yeah. You know, the Wales women are coming down to the Stoke Kairos as well in April, I think, for one of the Euro qualifiers. So the Welsh, the women's game is going from strength to strength.
Yeah, and what a chance for them and for Wrexham fans as well to see them at the Kairos. So please do buy tickets for that. It'll be a great occasion, I'm sure, again. Before Liam joined us, we were discussing, obviously, the win at Morecambe, and something maybe we wanted to talk about was Mullin and Palmer. Now that they have sort of been reunited up front the last few games, Liam, you know, is that sort of, you know, are we seeing the benefits from that? Is that, you know, is that now our established front line, you know, Fletcher off the bench, Mullin and Palmer starting?
Got to elaborate on your Liams here.
Oh yeah, there's two Liams now. Let's go. Liam Stokes-Massey first as the guest.
I say, yeah. I mean, it seems to have kind of not revitalised us, does it? But it's, you know, people have been calling for Ollie to kind of, you know, get back involved for what feels like weeks now. So to see him, I can't remember which game he came on. I think he came on for like the last 20 minutes. And within 5 minutes, like, he created like two chances. So it was, you know, that was a good sign there that he should probably be starting. So yeah, Saturday was, feels like, you know, in a way, a good away performance as well. It's,
rarity. Hopefully more to come. But no, I think, you know, Liam, other Liam, would you agree? And also tell us as well about what you hear.
I like the fact he's other Liam now. I heartily endorse that.
Get back on your radiator, get chained to it.
Other Liam, do you agree? And also, you know, there was a little tidbit this week as well about Mullin in The Athletic, wasn't there? Tell us about that.
Yeah, so I spotted it. Richard Sutcliffe had done a piece on Mullin, and I guess it was about his return to form, really. But there was an interesting tidbit going back to the summer. You might remember there was a few links in there with him in a move potentially to Saudi Arabia, which I think probably raised a few eyebrows. People weren't sure how seriously to take it. And I think potentially Mullin and his brother Greg were taking the mick out of it a bit, winding people up with it. But from what he said, so he's basically reflecting on Paul's sort of home life. He said, so settled his life with his partner Molly and son Albie that even serious interest from Saudi Arabia's second division last summer couldn't tempt him. So it sounds like there was actual, you know, real interest in there. I would say that I did think, you know, even if someone did throw silly money at him from Saudi, I just don't think it really fits in with, you know, we've seen on the documentary how important it is to him, his son and his partner. So didn't surprise me, but it was just interesting to get that confirmed. And just to say quickly on Ollie Palmer, it was good to see him back to his cheeky self in the post-match interview as well. I feel like he's been looking a bit downcast before he was brought back into the team, but he was ribbing James McLean about his goal. So good to see him back being his cheeky chappy self.
Yes, indeed. Andy, as a hotshot Fleet Street journalist, what can you tell us about the new international rights deal that the EFL For non-YouTube listeners, he didn't look very pleased.
It's Liam who wanted to talk about this bit. Can you not just ask Liam? Other yes, Liam?
I can. Other Liam, tell me about the EFL's international rights deal.
Hang on, I just want to get Andy's thoughts on it a bit more. I thought he he'd be all over that.
You know what, all the way through that, I thought he's going to come to me on the international rights, isn't he? I'm bugger all about him.
Not one of them was in that email stream that we saw.
Yeah, not one of them. Any administered by a 32 stone woman? No, I'm not interested.
So yeah, basically,
this is not a fattest podcast, as a disclaimer, just to put it out there.
Right, I'm going to dig us out of another hole there. So yeah, basically, it was announced this week that the EFL's got a new international TV rights deal for 4 seasons, which is 148 million quid, and it's a big increase on the previous one. I think it was 40% increase from the previous arrangement. A bit of a debate this week because, we seem to be the natural team to hang things on in terms of how much levels of interest we've attracted to the EFL. There was a bit of a debate with Simon Jordan on Talk Sport, where I know he's got a job to do in sort of trying to create controversy, but he was speaking a bit disrespectful about Robin Ryan, shall we say. I don't know what you guys think, but I mean, I don't think we're trying to say that we're the entire reason for this deal or anything like that, but I do think it's hard to dispute that we do draw eyeballs. Someone was saying, I think it was only this week, that they were over in New York in a sports bar with multiple screens, and the match most people were watching in there was Wrexham. So to deny that we have any impact at all, I think it's a bit harsh.
Tim, you love Simon Jordan, yeah?
I haven't given two shits about what he said. I'm not listening to any of it, to be honest. I sort of caught wind of some Wrexham fan taking umbrage of what he said, but I've never particularly cared what Simon Jordan or talk about, I have to say about Wrexham. The fact that they're talking about us tells you all you need to know. We're getting up people's noses, the right and the wrong people. You know, I keep saying it over and over again about the whole, you might not have heard of Wrexham, but you will do. And shock, surprise, everybody wants to have a bit of a bite, whether it's extra listeners, extra clickbait, whatever. You know, we are the in thing for however many years it may prove to be. So if it gets up people like ex-Crystal Palace chairman's nose, then long may it continue.
Indeed. I think everyone's skin's got a little bit thicker, hasn't it? But maybe there's this. It'll have to get thicker still if we keep climbing the divisions, because the attention will only and the wind-ups will only get greater. Before we talk about the week we've got coming up, 2 home games, it's time for our regular feature, the Book of Okonkwo.
Do a little jingle in there. That sounded like you set me up for a jingle.
He's only sung once.
I know. So could you sing again, but can you make it quick, please? Not that we don't want to hear it, but just because we want to wrap this up.
When Andy passes, he's having no music at his funeral. That is clear as day. He seems to hate music. So there we are. Right, what we got here? Andy foolishly and cleverly and shithousery, iruri, decided he was going to pitch Pavarotti, Ness and Dormer at me, which you wild people decided to vote for. I'm pretty much over my shitty man flu now. However, I'm still not there with it. I've got to do Pavarotti justice. So I'm asking for one final, I'll say this right now, one final week's grace, because I don't want to cause the heavens to open. Currently out here, it's bad. I mean, trying to turn Italian lyrics into English lyrics about an on-loan goalkeeper is quite difficult, believe it or not. So
you can't sing Puccini with the remnants of a chesty cough. I've always said that.
I've gone for a classic, right? I come up with something the other day. I thought that kind of works. I've not even sang it, so this could go horribly wrong, but do you remember the Louis Melt song? Remember that one? Spandau Ballet Gold? Kind of works for Big Arthur, to be honest. So let's see. It's got a build up to it. Andy's already turned his back to show his hostage haircut. Here we go. Come on. Come on, Tony Hadley. Here we go. Come on. Okonkwo plays for the Wrexham in goal. You got the power to know you're indestructible. Always believing. Okonkwo. There you go. Reese is thinking about it.
Hostage. Blue eyed soul there.
You're indestructible. He broke his bloody jaw against Harrogate.
Yeah, but he came back with a face mask on. Last we said, so yeah, you know.
Liam, how would you rate that one?
I mean, solid, I'd say. As solid as the other ones. All right, well done, Tim. Well
going to get a tin of paint and a paintbrush and get down that mural. Jokes.
Yes. Let Tim know what you think about his songs on online platforms. And you can also Andrew email Gilpin Andy Gilpin, AndrewGilpin at hotmail.com.
No, hang on.
That's AndrewGilpin at hotmail.com.
No Book of Okonkwo.
It's now a chapter of canon or canon chapter. So please forward all correspondence to Andrew Gilpin.
Why don't we call that Andy Carroll? I
don't
know.
Send big audio clips of you singing to Andrew Gilpin at hotmail.com.
He's just mentioned Andy Carroll in a vain
Andy
attempt.
Carroll's.
You've somehow managed to shoehorn a past it ponytail Geordie.
All right, okay.
Into this podcast. Fair play to you.
Okay.
And my song was bad. That was a worse link.
On that note, let's move on. Let's discuss the week to come. Potential 6 points here, right? Two home games. Feels like a real good chance, Andy, to sort of cement ourselves in that top three.
Yeah, I think confidence is flying at the moment. I think we've had a break as well, so we've had some time on the training pitch, which stood us in good stead on Saturday. I just feel that they've got the right balance in that team now. And as long as they don't have any more injuries, and who knows, because we seem to get an injury every week from the myriad of training grounds we go on. I feel that if you can keep that together, I would keep it for the next 3 or 4 weeks. And I think if I see the same unchanged 11 on Tuesday, I'll be happy. I think we'll win. And also, I think Tranmere, although it's a bit of a derby, I just think we're a better side and a better squad than them at the moment. They're having a few issues, and they're near, you know, round mid-table, bottom mid-table. So I can't see us slipping up. I think two wins, I really do.
So it's Harrogate up first on Tuesday. Then we've got Tranmere. Interestingly, any thoughts on best players who've played for both clubs? Tim, you suggested this. There are quite a few players who've crossed the divide, haven't there?
Yeah, I mean, it was Gary Bennett, but I wouldn't say he pulled up trees for Tranmere. So in recent times, I think Jay Harris has done well for both. Jennings, was it Connor or James? Yeah. Was it both?
Connor's still playing for Tranmere and doing pretty well, by all accounts.
I mean, you know, we share quite a few players because of the, you know, close proximity and location for a lot of the Northwest-based players. But I think Jay Harris probably have to be up there in recent times.
Andy Mangan. Just checked, he scored.
If you've got any suggestions, send them to Andrew Gilpin at Hotmail.
No, don't, please.
Liam Stokes-Massey, have you got anyone, anything to chuck in the hat? Oh, I can't think of any more myself, so sorry to put you on the spot.
No.
Okay, yeah. Good. That's a good, quick answer. Can we have you on every week?
Simple man.
Right, let's do predictions. Oh, one thing as well is we did have a positive Tom O'Connor news this week, didn't we, Andy? And he's not sure.
No, we did.
You look so bewildered every time I mentioned your name.
I'm not enjoying this one. I'm not having a good.
Please send your views on Tom O'Connor to Andrew Gilpin at Hotmail.
Would you stop doing that? Because honestly, right, I'm trying to do a good turn there, but you all just ruined it now.
Trying to do a good turn. Oh, fucking hell.
That email address down.
This is my favorite news is ever.
Tom O'Connor's injury is progressing well, and he's on his way back. We don't have a date.
And he shaved his mullet off.
Double good news. Everyone's happy. So let's do predictions. Let's start with Mr. Gilpin, so he can get out of the way.
As soon as this goes, I'm out of here. I'm going to go away, lick my wounds, and think about this.
Okay, mate. What's your predictions for the next 2 games? You said you think we'll win both. Give us some scores.
3-1 on Tuesday, and I think it will be a bit tighter on Saturday. I think it will be nervy, but I still think we'll get the job done. I think that'll be 2-1.
Okay. Other Liam?
Which one am I today? Am I other Liam or am I Liam? Who am I?
You're other Liam.
I'm other Liam, am I? Right. Yeah. Oh, forever known as that. I'm going to go and lick my wounds after that. Sorry, I'm gone. I'm going to go for...
Propose yourself. Go.
I'm going to go for 1-1 on Tuesday night because Harrogate have actually got a surprisingly decent away record. It's probably just a bit of emotional hedging because I think in the back of my mind, I'm probably fully expecting a win after the most recent game against Accrington, but there we go. And then Tranmere, we're going to win 3-1 on Saturday.
Nice. Tim?
Yeah, Harrogate, second best away form in the division behind Mansfield. So no pushovers and probably still want to piss us off because of the whole Luke Armstrong thing as well. That'll still be niggling away somewhere in the back of some of their minds. So I still think we'll have too much firepower. I agree with Andy. I think we're just in a good spot now after that weird wobble, which Crewe are now seemingly going through. We've seen two defeats in a row. So, yeah, I think a nice 2-0 back to a clean sheet. So 2-0 for Tuesday. And Tranmere, we should have absolutely put more than one on that goal at their place. It should have been 3 or 4. They're obviously a much better side now. Much tighter unit. Again, I'm in agreement with everybody so far. I just think we're going to have too much for them. And I'm just going to say 4-1.
Nice. I'm going to go 3-1 versus Harrogate. And I'm going to go with a draw against Tranmere. They've won a couple recently. So I'm going to say 1-1 next Saturday. And we'll give the final words to our guest, Liam.
I was actually going to say 4-1 for Tranmere as well. And then Tuesday night, I'll go 2-0. Home win 2-0.
It's a very confident business and devotion this week. Tim, what are you going to say?
Just say, obviously, Harrogate, second in the form league away from home. Tranmere, second bottom in the form league away from home. So there we are. Your 2-2 draw is very, very optimistic, but there we are.
Harrogate are on a dreadful run of form. They haven't won in about 6 games, but Tranmere have won 2 of their last 5. Just saying. Thanks all for listening. And we look forward to for you joining us next week. As usual, you can contact Tim in a variety of different ways. We have an email address, Andy. Do you want to remind people what that is?
Not mine.
what is the email address?
FIDZine@gmail.com, is it?
Yeah.
That email's been held hostage more than you have. So
it's that simple. Send an email to that address. It will get forwarded to us within 3 months. Thanks for listening and goodbye.
Take care. Cheers.
Bye. Sorry about this one.
Up the good turn, Reds.